بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين.
QSEP.com, your step-by-step guide to learning Islam online. Tawheed Explained from the book Aqidatul Tawheed by Sheikh Saleh bin Fawzan Al-Fawzan. Presentation and explanation by Dr. Abdullah Al-Farisi.
The next chapter, chapter 10, the Sheikh speaks about the Ruqyah and Tamimah. Ruqyah are sayings by the tongue with a recitation from Quran or du'as of the Prophet ﷺ that he taught us to use as means of curing. And Tamimah is something to write or to hang on, to hang upon yourself, or anything that you put either under the pillow or in the car or somewhere, this is tamimah. Now, regarding the ruqyah, what is being said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has explained that there are good ruqyahs and there are evil ruqyahs and bad ruqyahs, and sometimes even ruqyahs which could be great shirk that will take someone out of Islam. And regarding tamimahs, there are no good tamimas. According to the true hadiths, all tamimas are evil, all tamimas are bad. All tamimas are not allowed, even if it is from Quran itself. Even if you write Quran in something and hang it on your shoulder or put it under the pillow or whatever, this is called tamima. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not exclude in tamimas. He excluded in ruqya, and he said, show me your ruqyas, and then he said, whatever ruqya that is good, then you go ahead and use it, and whatever that is evil, you should not use, and therefore we have two kinds of ruqyas. But in cases of tamimah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made general statements about it. He didn't exclude anything. He didn't make two categories. And even though some of the companions or some of the scholars accepted the tamima in which only Quran is written, but still there are other companions of the Prophet ﷺ, there are most of the scholars disapprove of this. Why? Because what is written is usually hidden, you cannot see, and most of the common people don't even care to ask what is written. What could be written is something very bad. So as long as this kind of tamima might lead to the evil tamima, then it should be forbidden also, and it should not be accepted. And because the Prophet ﷺ made a general statement that every tamima is bad, every tamima is evil, so how could we say some are good and some are evil, when the Prophet ﷺ said, he who hangs on a tamima, he has committed shirk. And he didn't exclude. The Prophet ﷺ did not exclude. Now, regarding the ruqyah, the Sheikh says, the first kind is the kind which is free from any shirk, free from any words of shirk, free from any statements of shirk. It is read on a sick person, whether it is Quran or names of Allah, attributes of Allah, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has used ruqyah, and he has ordered to use ruqyah, and he has allowed to use ruqyah. Auf ibn Malik, one of the companions, may Allah be pleased with him, said, we were using ruqyah even in the time of jahiliyyah, before Islam, in the time of ignorance. So we said, O Messenger of Allah, what do you think of that? That is using the ruqyah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, show me the ruqyahs you use. And then he said, it is okay to use the ruqyah as long as it does not involve shirk. and this is narrated by a Muslim. As-Suyuti, one of the Muslim scholars, said, "It is the consensus of the Muslim scholars that the ruqyah is allowed with three conditions. It has to be using the Quran, word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or names of Allah and his attributes. And it has to be with Arabic tongue. It cannot be with other than Arabic tongue. And it has to be something understandable. It cannot be just vague words or things like boo, whatever, you know, those magicians do, you know. Or even if you write words, they have to be known words and understandable words. And the third condition, which is very important, that is to believe that the ruqyah does not affect by itself. This is very important. Whatever ruqyah it is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the curer. And this is only a means. It could work and it could not work. It's up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the way to do this ruqyah is to recite and to blow what you recite. You blow it on the place of pain, on the sick person. Or you recite and blow in water and make him drink the water, as has come in a hadith by Thabit ibn Qais, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took some dust, some sand, and he put it in a small pot, and then he recited and blew on it with water powered on it. So this has been used as a ruqyah. This is okay to use. The second kind of ruqyah is the kind of ruqyah which is not free from shirk, such as the wordings which include supplicating to the devils, seeking assistance from the devils, or names other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you supplicate to other names, whether devils or humans. If you supplicate to other than Allah, then it is shirk. Even if you call it a ruqyah, it is shirk. If your ruqyah involves supplication to other than Allah, then this is great shirk. Or using names of jinn or shayateen, or even names of angels and prophets and pious people. No other names but Allah's names can be used in the ruqyahs. So all this involves shirk and supplication to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, using non-Arabic words or non-understandable words, this might not reach the level of being shirk, but it is also haram. You cannot use the non-Arabic words or the non-understandable words, because those words which you don't understand, they might contain shirk also. Now, regarding the tamimas, the Sheikh says, tamima is what is hanged on, for example, the children as a safeguard from diseases. The mother, for example, puts some kind of writings or some kinds of bracelets or some kinds of necklace, some kinds even of small thread or whatever, blue things, blue glass, whatever, anything that is hanged, this is called tamima. And it falls under the tamima. And also the Sheikh says, we have the first kind of tamimas, that is where only Quran or names of Allah and the attributes of Allah are written. He says the scholars have differed in regards to the ruling of such tamima. And some scholars said it's okay, like the companion Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-As radiyallahu anhuma, and some other companions, and some narrations about some scholars like Imam Ahmad in one narration about him. The second opinion regarding this is that it is forbidden, and this has been narrated about Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Abdullah ibn Abbas, and Hudhayfa, all companions of the Prophet ﷺ. and Uqba ibn Amir and ibn Ukaym, all companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and many of the students of the companions have made it haram also. And another narration about Imam Ahmad, he said it is haram, and most of his followers followed this narration. And contemporary Hanbalis say that this is the right thing, that is not to put a tamima, even if it is from Quran. And also there is another form of tamima which is called tiwala, and that is actually made to make the woman love her husband, or to make the man loved to his wife, something like that. Yani something they hang on the woman, claiming that her husband would love her more by doing this, or the opposite. Of course, Sheikh Al-Fawzan finds that even the tamima from Quran is haram. He says for three reasons: because the Prophet ﷺ made a general forbiddance, he did not make any exclusion. The second is to cut any means of falling into shirk, to cut any means of falling into shirk. And also because if he hangs Quran, he might go into the bathroom and he might sleep on it, he might sit on it, he might do anything, which is haram. So this is another reason. Then the second kind of tamimas, the Sheikh says, whatever is hanged on people other than Quran, like the small glasses, whatever you call them, like bones, like ropes, like bracelets, even sometimes slippers, shoes, whatever. And those things might involve names of the devils and involve ununderstandable words. This is indeed haram, and it is from shirk, because it is a form of dependence upon other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, he who hangs on anything, then he is left alone with that thing which he hangs on. It will not support you. If Allah does not support you, it will not support you. If Allah does not support you, nothing will support you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has declared that he will not support you if he hang on any of those things. Some people use certain kind of haram medicine in this. Some people use the graves and the dust of the graves and so on. The Muslim has the duty to protect his faith and his belief from anything that might spoil it in any way. So he should not put money to buy those kinds of means, because all these are haram means and sometimes they involve shirk. A Muslim should not go to the superstitious people who indulge in those actions, right, things to be hanged on or something like that. One should stay away from them and never go near them. And some people actually put on those tamimas even when they are not sick, thinking that if they don't put it, they will be subject to harm. And this is a kind of disease in itself, to fear from non-existing things and to imagine things. This will lead to more fearing, and this will lead to more superstition. So the Muslim has to put his trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and know that it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who is above all things. He is the one who is the protector. He is the one who owns all good and evil. So how could you fear imaginary things? And therefore, put on some kind of bracelets or whatever. So this is in regarding to the tamima. Then the Sheikh speaks about the ruling regarding swearing by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the ruling of tawassul and supplication, istighatha, and seeking assistance from the dead and so on. First, the swearing by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To swear by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is actually haram, and it is small shirk, and sometimes it could be great shirk if the one who swears by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala believes that the person whom he is swearing with is equal to Allah in his attributes or in his rights. Some people go to the degree that when they are asked to swear by Allah, they do fearlessly. And when they are asked to swear by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they don't, because they believe that swearing by this person is a sure harm, you know. So this is great shirk. This will take someone out of Islam, because he is not treating the creature like Allah only. He is treating him more than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is fearing him more than Allah. He is not only fearing him like Allah. If he fears him like Allah, he is committing great shirk. So how about if he fear him more than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So swearing by other than Allah is shirk. Swearing by the Kaaba is shirk, because Kaaba is not Allah. It's not an attribute of Allah. Kaaba is stones. It is a creature of Allah. It is called the house of Allah because of its honor. Just like the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is called the slave of Allah, it's an honor for him. Just like the camel which was sent to the people of Salih, it is called the camel of Allah, Naqatullah. It is an honor for it. The camel of Allah does not mean that it has anything to do with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and so on. No. So when we swear by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this is small shirk. And this is a great sin, because small shirk does not mean that it is a small sin. It is small shirk, but it's a great sin. It is much greater than the rest of great sins. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, من حلف بغير الله فقد كفر أو أشرك. He who swears by other than Allah, then he has either committed kufr or shirk. And as we said, it is small shirk and small kufr. The people who worship the graves nowadays fear the creatures more than fearing Allah, and fear the persons whom they are swearing by more than fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Quran, وَحْفَظُوا أَيْمَانَكُمْ, protect your swears, meaning protect them from anything haram. For example, to break your swear, this is haram. And to swear by other than Allah, this is even more haram. This is shirk, small shirk. So you would not be protecting your swearing if you swear by other than Allah. Just like you will not be protecting your swearing if you swear and lie, or if you swear that you will do something haram. If you say, I swear by Allah that I will do such and such haram thing, then you are not protecting your swear. And you have to break your swear here. You cannot do a haram. If you swear by Allah to do a haram thing, you cannot do it. You have to make up for it. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in a true hadith that there are three types of people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not purify them and will not look at them in the day of judgment, and he will punish them severely. And he mentioned a person who buys and sells by false swears. The Prophet ﷺ says, a man who makes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala subject to his buying and selling by swearing in him falsely. So it is haram, clearly, to swear by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if you swear by the honor, or by the Kaaba, or by the Messenger, or by your head, or by your soul, whatever. All swearings are shirk. All swearings by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on something which is a lie is a great sin. And it is called al-yamin al-ghamus, that immerses the person in sin. If this is called yamin al-ghamus, then the swearing by other than Allah is even greater than this. يعني اليمين الغموس is to swear by Allah but lying. And this is called يمين الغموس. It immerses you in sin. It makes you immersed in a lot of sin. So how about swearing by other than Allah? This is even worse. And also, one should not make his habit to swear a lot, because this will make lying in your swearing easy. يعني, you should not swear on silly things. You don't have to say, by Allah, I'm going to drink this glass of water. Why do you have to say this? يعني, the Prophet ﷺ, his swears are counted. In all his life, you could count how many times he sweared. Ibn al-Qayyim has a book called أقسام النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, the swearings of the Prophet ﷺ. That means the Prophet ﷺ might have been swearing once in a year or twice in a year. So you could see how one should respect Allah and not make swearing in Allah and swearing by Allah something which is very easy and silly. You know, I swear by Allah, you should do this. I swear by Allah, you should do that. I swear. Then you will become used to swearing by Allah, and you can swear easily and lie. And the fourth thing is that when you need to swear by Allah, or it is necessary, then you can do so. No problem. Regarding tawassul, tawassul comes from word tawassul. Seen and sad. Tawassul, seen here. S. Tawassul, sad. Sad. But they are the same meaning. Tawassul is from what carries you, or what makes you reach something. That's tawassul. Wasala means arrived. Wusul, arrival. So to make you arrive to some point, or to reach some point, this is tawassul. And this is tawassul. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, ابتغوا إليه الوسيلة. This is an order. Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما says, الوسيلة القربة. What brings you closer to Allah? That is the meaning of وسيلة. And that is the meaning of وصيلة. What is the thing which carries you to the pleasure of Allah, which makes you arrive to the pleasure of Allah? It is the obedience. The qurbah is the obedience, what you please Allah with. This is the wasila. Now the mushriks say the wasila is a sheikh. They claim that to put someone between you and Allah, this is wasila. How could this be wasila? To put someone between you and Allah is opposite to wasila altogether. Because wasila is something liked by Allah, not something hated mostly by Allah. To put something between you and Allah, that is great shirk, wasita. That is the shirk of Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described their shirk in Quran. He said, do they have shufa'a that they sit between them and Allah? Shafi' is an intermediary between them and Allah. And the mushriks say in Quran, مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى. We are not worshipping them but as means between us and Allah, to bring us closer to Allah. And they say, هَؤُلَاءِ شُفَعَاؤُنَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. They are our mediators to Allah. That's their shirk. That's the shirk. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in a verse the four types of shirk, first he said to believe that someone owns anything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one owns anything except Allah. He is the only owner. He is the only king. And then he said in the same verse, those who share with Allah the ownership of anything. No one shares. So you have to disbelieve in this. And the third one he said, وَمَا لَهُ مِنْ ظَهِيرٍ. He doesn't have a supporter. No creature supports Allah. Allah did not create anything to support him. He is in no need of anything. He is in no need of angels. He is in no need of the throne. He is in no need of someone to carry the throne. He is in no need of anything. And then the fourth thing was the shirk of the Arabs, which Allah also mentioned in this verse. He said, وَمَا لَهُم مِّن شَفِيعٍ. They have no one who can be a mediator between them and me. So this is now those grave worshippers who call themselves Muslims, they believe that the sheikhs are shafi'. And Allah said there is no such thing. And this was the shirk of the Arabs. And this was the shirk of Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab. And those people say shufa'a. They say shafi'a also. But most of them call it wasila. Why? Because wasila is a good word. It has a good meaning. It's like making some kinds of words which include shirk and call it ruqya. Right? Ruqya is good. The Prophet ﷺ used ruqya. But not everything is called ruqya. And those people are saying that we can have intercessors between us and Allah who can carry our needs to Allah, and they call this wasila. This is worse than what the Americans say about fornication. What do they call it? Do you know? They call it love. They call it making love, right? Love and making love is something beautiful. Okay? And they even sing it, huh? We make love and this, right? And those people call shirk wasila. Same thing. Even worse, because fornication is a sin. It is not shirk. Okay? So if you call it love, you have committed less of a crime than those people who do the same thing as Abu Jahl and set up a rival between them and Allah. They call him a wali and a sheikh and so on, and the Shias call him imam and whatever, sayyid, huh? They call him sayyid, they call him imam, they call him wali, they call him a sheikh, you know, whatever name. But they call the whole process wasila. So when you tell them, why do you commit shirk? Why do you put between you and Allah someone? Is it enough to call Allah? Is it not enough to call Allah alone? Does Allah need anyone to carry someone's complaint to him? Does Allah need anyone to make him mercy to you, merciful to you? Is there anyone who is more merciful than Allah? Yani those people are very stupid. They are stooges. They are thinking so much evil about Allah by this action. Because when you say, I have to put a person between me and Allah, you are actually claiming many false claims about Allah. You are claiming that Allah did not pay attention to you. He did not know your situation, which is a'udhu billah, kufr. You are claiming that Allah needs some creature to go to him and tell him, be merciful to this brother and that brother. How could you believe this? How could you believe that Allah's mercy is short? Allah is most merciful. Allah says, وَمَنْ أَضَلُّ مِمَّنْ يَدْعُو مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ. Who is more astray than those who call others besides Allah? There is no one more astray, because this involves a lot of bad thinkings about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually. So you cannot say, I put someone between me and Allah. This is nothing. This is false. We don't deny the concept of shafa'ah altogether. But we deny the shirki shafa'ah. You see, there are two kinds of shafa'ah in Quran. And one, in some verses, Allah says, they have no shafi'ah. Right? And in some verses, Allah says, they make shafa'ah by his will, by his permission, and by his pleasure. So we have two kinds of shafa'ah. One which is denied, and one which is approved. The one which is denied is the shirki shafa'ah, like the mushriks had. And that is to set up a rival or to set up someone between you and Allah. The Arabs used to set angels between them and Allah. And they call them our Shafi', our Wasita, our intermediary. And they used to put pious people between them and Allah, like Yaghuth, wa Ya'uq, wa Wad, wa Nasr. Abdullah ibn Abbas, the companion, the great Mufassir, says, these are names of walis, pious people, that the mushriks used to make them intercessors between them and Allah. Even the name Al-Lat, which they made as a big idol. Al-Lat was a man, as Ibn Abbas also said, explaining the verse, he was a man, a pious man, in Hajj time for the Arabs, used to make food for them and things like that. So when he died, they used to make him as an intercessor between them and Allah, and they made a statue for him, an idol, and so on, due to respecting him. So they call this tawassul, and this is not tawassul. This is not tawassul. To supplicate to the awliya, they call it tawassul. To put the wali between them and Allah as an intermediary, they say this is tawassul. And all those actions are actions of shirk. To supplicate to the wali is istighatha. This is great shirk. To set up someone between you and Allah is wasita. And this is great shirk in Islam. So therefore, they say, we are doing tawassul. The Sheikh says here, at-tawassul are two forms or two kinds. We have something called tawassul, which is good and allowed. And it is many types, which is allowed. The first type is to make tawassul by the names of Allah, the attributes of Allah, like saying, oh Allah, the most merciful, be merciful to me. This is tawassul. You are making tawassul by Allah's names and attributes. And Allah said in Quran, وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَادْعُوهُ بِهَا. To Allah belongs the most beautiful names. So call him by those names, using those names. And the second kind of tawassul, which is also allowed, is to make tawassul by your own good deeds. Like those three who were trapped in a cave. And then they didn't know how to get out. So they made tawassul to Allah by their own good deeds. And finally, Allah made a way out for them by their own good deeds. They say, oh Allah, I have done such and such and such. So if I have done it for your sake, then reward me with this or do this for me. This is a good tawassul because you are doing tawassul with your own good deeds. But the mushriks use other people's deeds as a wasila for them. How could this be? وَلَا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةٌ وِزْرَ أُخْرَى وَأَنْ لَيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى. That the man does not benefit except that which he has earned by himself. You cannot benefit from what I earn. I don't give you my what I earn. Okay, so they use the good deeds of others. They say, Fulan is a good man, so let's make tawassul by him. You see? The third one is to make tawassul by the tawheed, like Yunus alayhi salam did when he said, Subhanaka la ilaha illa ant, inni kuntu min al-zalimin. He used tawheed as his way of tawassul. That, oh Allah, there is no one but you. You are the only one worthy of being worshipped. And I have been doing a lot of injustice to myself, so forgive me. And the fourth form is when someone makes tawassul to Allah by showing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala how needy he is of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and how humble and humiliated he is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he showed this to Allah, and this is a way of tawassul. And the fifth is by the dua of the pious people who are alive. You go to someone who is alive, who can make dua for you and ask him to make dua. This is okay because he can. He can make dua. Whether it will be accepted or not, this is something else. But you go to him and tell him, ask him, or by phone, call him and tell him to make dua for you. That's okay. But not when he is dead. When he is dead, he cannot make dua for you. He cannot even hear you, even though this is a controversial matter. But it is not controversial that he cannot respond. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْ سَمِعُوا مَا اسْتَجَابُوا لَكُمْ. Even if they were to hear, they will not respond. They will not respond. And the sixth form of the allowed tawassul, the Shaykh says, is to submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and admit to him all your wrongs. This is between you and Allah. And in secret, between you and Allah, you show your submission and your repentance as a means of tawassul. Now, the Shaykh says, the second kind is the unallowed, the forbidden tawassul. And under it, he puts many forms. First, that is to ask the dead people to make dua for you. This is haram. This is haram. The Shaykh says, because the dead person cannot make dua. Because when he was alive, all his means to cooperate and to deal with this life, he had eyes to see, he had ears, and so on. All these things will be gone. And all his actions will be cut. As the Prophet ﷺ says, إِذَا مَاتَ ابْنُ آدَمٍ انْقَطَعَ عَمَلُهُ. When the son of Adam dies, then this equals what? All his actions will be cut. Now his hearing is an action. His hearing is an action. His seeing is an action. His response is an action. In whatever way, in dua or whatever, all those are gone. And there is no difference amongst Muslims regarding this. The only difference is the hearing, whether he can hear or not. This is a controversial issue. But those people who are saint worshippers nowadays, they claim that the person who dies, the wali, is in a life which is more powerful than the life that he was in. What they mean by this is that he not only can hear and see and everything that he was doing in this life, but even more. And they claim that his soul was imprisoned in this body when he was alive. But when he dies, his soul will go outrageous, will go everywhere at once. This is a complete contradiction to the verse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the dead person that he holds his soul. فَيُمْسِكُ الَّتِي قَضَى عَلَيْهَا بِالْمَوْتِ. Allah holds his soul. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala holds his soul. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained this. He said that the souls of the disbelievers are in hellfire. They are imprisoned in hellfire. They are not free everywhere. They are imprisoned before they were imprisoned in this body, as they claim. But now they are imprisoned in hellfire. Okay. And the Prophet ﷺ says, أرواح المؤمنين معلقة بأشجار الجنة. The souls of the believers will be hanged on trees in paradise. A soul that is hanged in a tree in paradise. What do you think of it? Do you think that it will be crazy to leave that place and come to this filth? Who thinks that? Plus, it cannot do it. It cannot, because it's there by the order of Allah. It's not free. And even if it's free, no one who is sane leaves that place, beauty in heavens, huh? And comes in this filth compared to paradise, huh? No one. And the souls of the martyrs are in the hearts of birds which are flying everywhere in paradise. So how could they leave their places and come to this life and wonder about me and this and that and that? This is not nonsense. So when we say that it is life in the barzakh, which is after death, it is a life which is totally different than this life. It has nothing to do with this life. Otherwise, there is no meaning for death. Then what is the meaning of the death? Why did the companions put the Prophet ﷺ in the grave under the sand when Fatima radiallahu anha was weeping, huh? And saying, how could yourselves allow you to bury the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam because of her emotions? How could yourselves allow you to put dust on him? Huh? Why would they do so? Why? If he was alive fully and he, as they claim, he is amongst us and he knows all what we know. And he, as a matter of fact, in their books they say that he has intercourse with his wives and all that. I read this in their books. Okay? So that means that the Prophet ﷺ and the Walis, as they claim, they are living everything that they were and more. Okay? Then what is the meaning of death? Why is it called death? And why does the Prophet ﷺ says, when son of Adam dies, all his action are cut? Who are we to believe? Those stooges or the Prophet ﷺ, who is speaking from a revelation from Allah, and those speaking from revelation from Iblis to them? They have nothing but revelation from the devil to them. As Ibn Abbas explained the verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إن الشياطين ليوحون إلى أوليائهم زخرف القول. Shayateen reveal to their allies the false beautified talk. Okay, so they have nothing but junk as proofs. You know, of course the wali is alive, but his life is different. His life pertains to a middle course life that is between this world and the hereafter. It has nothing to do with this life. All the means that he was using in this life are lost. Okay. And even if he were to hear, Allah can make him hear. Okay. Even if he were to hear, he cannot respond definitely. And this is said in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, even if they were, وَلَوْ سَمِعُوا مَا اسْتَجَابُوا لَكُمْ. Even if they were to hear, they would not be able to respond to you. وَيَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ يَكْفُرُونَ بِشِرْكِكُمْ. In the day of judgment, they will deny your shirk. The fact that you are supplicating to them is shirk. They, on the day of judgment, they will deny it. Even if they were calling to it in this life, like Sufi sheikhs and Shia sheikhs, they call their people to supplicate to them after death. But in the day of judgment, they will deny it because of their fear. They say, no. Okay? Just like Shaitan on the day of judgment. He will declare his total innocence of anything bad. And he says, I have nothing to do with you. You know? Why? Because he sees the punishment in front of him. So anyway, the Sheikh goes on saying that the first kind of illegal tawassul is to ask the dead people to make dua, and this is not allowed, the Sheikh says, because the dead people, the dead person, cannot make dua. And then the Sheikh also adds to this, asking shafa'ah from the dead person. This is haram. Asking shafa'ah from him, this is haram. This is shirk. This is great shirk. And then the Sheikh says, the fact that asking dua from him is haram is clear from the proofs. Umar radiallahu anh, after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did not go to his grave and ask him to make dua. No, he asked someone alive. He asked Al-Abbas. Why would he ask Al-Abbas when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was there, but dead? And not only dead, but his body is as is in the grave, the Prophet. Despite that, no companion ever thought to go and ask the Prophet ﷺ to make dua for them after his death. No companion has ever thought to go and ask the Prophet ﷺ for any fatwa. They had a lot of troubles and problems amongst them. They didn't go and ask the Prophet ﷺ. Why? They had problems to the degree that they fought each other and killed each other. Why didn't they go and ask the Prophet ﷺ? Why? Because that's it. The Prophet ﷺ would not respond to them. If he would respond, they would go and ask. They are more knowledgeable than anyone else, the companions. They had more knowledge than anyone else. Muawiyah, the same thing. When in his time asked one companion to make dua, and he did not go to the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The second kind of forbidden tawassul is to make tawassul by the honor of the Prophet sallallahu or the honor of the walis, the others. And the Prophet sallallahu, they report a hadith about him saying, if you were to ask Allah, ask him by my honor, because my honor is great to Allah. This is a fabricated hadith. Fabricated, not only weak, but lied, forged. And of course, the Prophet ﷺ has a great honor. But who is to say that we can use his honor in this way? No one. And the third kind of forbidden tawassul is to seek tawassul by the creature's selves, someone's self, whoever it might be. And the fourth kind of forbidden tawassul is to seek tawassul by someone's right upon Allah or something, as they say. Because no one has a right upon Allah, that's one thing. Allah has all the favor on us. No one has the right upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He gave us bounties not because they are rights on him. It's because he is generous. That's all. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made those things يعني, as something upon him, not because it is a duty on him. No. There is another hadith which says, أسألك بحق السائلين. I ask you, Allah, with the right of those who ask you. This is also weak. But even if you say it is true, then حق السائلين means what you, Allah, made a right upon yourself, that is to answer the call of those who call you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبُ أُجِيبُ. If they were to ask you about me, O Muhammad, then I am near, I will answer their call. So he made it something upon himself. إِن تَنْصُرُ اللَّهَ يَنْصُرْكُمْ. Were you to give victory to Allah, Allah will give victory to you. احفظ الله يحفظك. Protect Allah by protecting His orders and following His orders, Allah will protect you.
Because amongst us, there are innocent children, there are women, and so on and so forth. If this guidance goes to Allah, will Allah?
If it is meant to show Allah our weakness, yes, inshallah. It depends on what he means, you know. Usually that's what they mean. If they are scholars or students of knowledge who say this dua, usually this is what they mean. To show their weakness and need to Allah. Okay. It is also narrated that in istisqa, in asking Allah rain, you would bring out along you in your dua, you bring out the women and children and weak people to show Allah that you are in need of Him. Allah likes this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes that we show our need for Him because we are slaves. So when you show your slavery, then that's something which Allah likes. Some of the Salaf used to come and put their heads down on the sand and in that position ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a sign of humbleness and weakness. Some of them would use words. They would say, فَقِيرُكَ بدارك، مسكينك بدارك. That we are your فقير. We are your مسكين. We are the ones who are in need of you. Right? So this is good way of توسل. Next, the author, His Honor Sheikh Saleh Al-Fawzan, may Allah prolong his life on obedience to him, says, the ruling regarding seeking support or assistance, isti'ana, and supplication, which is to call upon someone in hardship times, in difficulties, this is called istighatha. The only difference between istighatha and dua is that dua is general. Whenever you ask someone, then you are making dua to him. But istighatha is making dua in hardships and difficulties. And istighatha and isti'ana are two types. One is to seek support and to supplicate to the creature with that which is within his capabilities. And this is okay. There is nothing wrong with that, let alone considering it a form of shirk. It is not haram, it is not shirk. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Quran, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى. Support each other with that which is piety and righteousness. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said also regarding the story of Prophet Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, when the Israelites sought Musa's support by supplicating to him or calling upon him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned this in Quran saying, فَاسْتَغَاثَهُ الَّذِي مِنْ شِيعَتِهِ عَلَى الَّذِي مِنْ عَدُوِهِ. This is Surah Al-Qasas, verse 15. And this is just like any normal supplication when someone calls upon his friend or any other person in that which the person whom he is calling upon can do something, can help him in it, something which is within his capabilities. The second form of supplication and seeking assistance is to do that with the creature in a matter that no one can do but Allah. No one can help you but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Something which no one is capable to do except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like, for example, calling upon a dead person to support you. The dead person cannot do that thing which you are asking him from. No one can do it to you but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or even if you were supplicating to a live person, a person who is alive, in a manner that he is not capable to do what you are asking him, like supplicating to someone who is far away from you. You are, let's say, in Kuwait and he is in Britain, or he is in China, and you shout asking him for support. Of course, this is a kind of hallucination and it is great shirk. It is not from the supplication which is allowed in Islam. Or even if he was near you, but you call him to bring back the dead alive, this is something which cannot be done except by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or you want him to guarantee the cure of some person who is deceased or some person who is ill, severely ill, because no one owns to lift the harm of the ill person except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the kind of supplication and seeking support that is considered to be great shirk. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when some companions said at his time, let us make استغاثة to the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. Let us seek support or let us supplicate to the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. Because one hypocrite was harming them, so they wanted to get rid of his harm, and they said, let us supplicate to the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, so that we get rid of this or get rid of the evil of this hypocrite. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم did not like what they said, and he said, إنه لا يستغاث بي, إنما يستغاث بالله. Now here the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم apparently found it difficult for himself to do anything in regards to this hypocrite. As a matter of fact, the hypocrites were harming the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself so much at his time, to the degree that they accused his most beloved wife of falling into something haram, and he couldn't do anything when he found out who was the source of this lie and who was the source of this false and great accusation to his wife Aisha radiallahu anha. Despite that, the Prophet ﷺ could not do anything to that person, Abdullah ibn Abi Salul, the head of the hypocrites. And the Prophet ﷺ, when some hypocrite shouted at him and said something bad to him, he didn't do anything to him. Some companions suggested to kill him. The Prophet ﷺ said, no, let not the people say that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is killing his companions, because even though he's a hypocrite, but apparently he's a Muslim, and when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam kills him, then it will spread that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is killing his companions, and they will probably spread it in a way that is harmful to Islam, to distort the picture of Islam. So that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in those times where he found it unwise to punish those hypocrites, he did not. So here, when the companion said, let us seek support from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam disliked this statement. He said, support is not sought from me, it is only sought from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is a way of showing humbleness in his abilities, with respect to the abilities of the Creator, the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and also to close all the gates which lead to shirk. So if this was the situation in his lifetime where he could do something, at least do anything, then how about after his death? Who could claim that he has the right to go and supplicate to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam after his death? In his lifetime, when he was alive and the companions sought assistance from him and sought support from him, and he could not, and he said, no one should say, let us seek support from the Messenger, or no one should say, let us supplicate to the Messenger, because support is only from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if this is the situation with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then how about others? So who is to claim after this that he can go and seek support from such and such wali who is either dead or unpresent in the place where he is asked, or unable to do what he is asked to do? This was the end of the chapter regarding the istighatha and supplication. And as I said earlier, that the mushriks nowadays, who attribute themselves falsely to Islam, claim that what they are doing, which is great shirk, that is to supplicate to the dead, for example, they claim that this is tawassul, and this has nothing to do with tawassul. And we explained what tawassul meant and what supplication means.